Hello and welcome to this video. My name's Barry Beckham. This MP4 video has been recorded at full HD resolution of 1920 by 1080 pixels. So it should play full screen on Windows PCs, Apple Mac computers, mobile devices, and also most modern televisions. This is an infrared image shot with a converted Canon 5D Mark II camera. The magenta cast is caused by the visible light blocking filter that's placed over the sensor, which blocks most of the visible light, allowing invisible light, the infrared spectrum, to reach the sensor. The color cast isn't a problem to us, and notice how low in contrast infrared images can be. Very similar to standard images shot in overcast conditions. The manipulation of an infrared image like this is really no different from any other. Apart from here, we will go immediately to monochrome and we will work through the image from that point. If I was about to manipulate a standard color image into a black and white, I'd be using the self-same techniques as I will here. I think the two main issues we have here is identifying and achieving that sparkling monochrome contrast we're going to need to lift the image, and also we've got three power lines running through the sky in a very obtrusive position and we need to deal with those two. But as I said, the manipulation is very similar to any other shot, and my place to start would be with the lens corrections, and I would be ticking the box to enable the lens corrections. Photoshop has picked up the fact that I was using a Canon 24 to 105mm lens, and I think I probably had it set at the wide end at that point. Every lens has a little bit of distortion that's known within the lens, and here Photoshop's providing the profile. If I untick the box, you can see the difference that it makes. Sometimes it doesn't make a great deal of difference, sometimes it does. We could argue that there's not a great need to tick the box to remove chromatic aberration, because my next port of call is back to my basic tab to take all of the saturation out of the image. So I don't think there's much doubt that 90% of the work we need to do here is getting the tonal values right to create a sparkling monochrome image. Sometimes I look at the effects tab and I even add a bit of dehaze, but let me just do that, then come back to the main tab and look at the histogram, because the histogram is telling me I've got deficiencies on this side and a little bit here too. So I could increase the exposure a touch, I could increase the highlights a bit, and you can see the histogram spreading a little bit, and then some whites to push it really to that side to get it sparkling on screen, albeit sparkling a little too much in the middle top left at the moment, but it's a start. We need to do something with the black, so I'm going to bring the black slider down. Now when we're looking at the histogram looks a much better. It's stretching from one side to the other. But we still have quite a dark area here, which you would expect, it's in shadow. And we've got quite a bright area here. Now that's not uncommon with the images we need to manipulate, whether we're working in Photoshop, Lightroom, or any other software. Now I'm looking at the right bottom corner here, and I think it does look a little bit dark. I'm going to raise the shadow detail a little bit. I'm going to raise the exposure a little bit, but of course you can see that that impacts the rest of the image rather too much. So I think what I'm going to do is to manipulate this image in two complete halves, because you can almost see a diagonal line more or less, or a curved diagonal line right the way across here. So we've got a third of the image in shadow and we don't want that too dark. Two thirds of the image in more bright light and we don't want that too bright. So I'm going to open this image up as a smart object, Smart object status can be turned on from the hyperlink at the bottom of the screen, and there it is there. When I select that, you'll notice the button says open object, so I can open this up into Photoshop. As soon as I do, I'll bring the layers out on screen. We can see that this is a smart object by the little symbol at the bottom right. So what we need to do now is to make a copy of this so we can adjust the lighter tones independently to that bottom third edge. To do that, we move to the right of the thumbnail, right click, and select New Smart Object via Copy. So this one here is going to be, let's say, bottom right, and this one is going to more or less be our top left. So I can open up my top left now back into Adobe Camera Raw by double clicking. Now I can adjust this for the light tones, ignoring the effect in the dark areas. So I think I'll double click the whites to remove that slider, double click the highlights to remove that slider, and I'll bring the exposure down. I'm going to bring the clarity way up. In fact, did I add clarity last time with the bottom corner? I'm not sure that I did. I'll check that in a minute. But now I've added that, it's a little bit too dark maybe. So I'm just going to lift it a bit so I've got a bit of sparkle there. That's not looking too bad at all. I'm going to open this up now, clicking OK. Of course, we don't see any change because it's sitting below this layer, but it's there. Now I'm just going to double click this one because I think I neglected, yes I did, I neglected to put a bit of clarity into the foreground, which has also affected the shade of it. So I'm going to lift that a little bit and reopen that. But of course, all these little tweaks and adjustments are no problem at all because we're working with smart objects. Every time we go back into Camera Raw, we're not adding change upon change. We're always working on the original raw data. So all we need here is a layer mask to be able to blend the two together. Now we could switch these around. Now I'm going to drag one down below this because it's going to be easier, I think, to just mask a little bit of this one to allow just the bottom corner to be lighter. So I'm going to apply a mask. I could have done it the other way and masked all this area, but it makes sense, I hope you'll agree, to switch them around. So now we've only got to mask this area. I'm going to pick up my gradient tool. I'm going to choose black as my foreground color. From the options at the top of the screen, we need to choose this option, which is the linear gradient, which is the default setting, and the one on the left of those five. From the option just to the left of that, we need to choose foreground to transparent. The little checkerboard effect here signifies that we're going to be spraying onto a mask which is in effect transparent, although we appear to see it as white over on the right, but we're spraying the gradient beginning with black. So we do much the same as we would with a gradient in Adobe Camera Raw or even Lightroom. We can draw a line, and that determines where the gradient is going to be provided from the solid part to the completely transparent part. And we can do this more than once. And because we're working on a mask here, it's very easy to flood the mask with white and have another go. But we also get the opportunity to tweak the mask a little bit because we can see shading down the top right corner on the trees there. So with the mask selected, I could pick up now my brush, making sure I've got a very low flow rate, probably less than that. I'm going to go down to 2%, and I'm just going to spray up in that area. Can you just see that the tones are being gradually lifted? When you get to edges like this, try not to go too tight to the edge. Sometimes you're better off doing this and allowing it to be more gradual. It's much easier on the eye. And of course, while I've got the mask in play and a nice bright image sitting below here, if I felt there was a need to lighten some of these areas, then now I've got the opportunity to do it. I can bring my brush down. I'll make about a 10%, but you can see I'm going to do this a little bit quick and dirty, but you can see how it wouldn't be too difficult to lift tones in these areas as well if we felt it was necessary to do that. Obviously, I am working very, very quick and dirty here. We would work a little bit more carefully if this was being done as a really legitimate piece of work. But for a video, I need to be a little bit quicker and give you an idea of what you can do rather than do everything in its entirety. But you do see we've got a little problem over on the left-hand side. So here I probably would take it down, take the brush down, take even the flow down to 5%. And if necessary, I'm doing a little anti-clockwise circular motion here. So you can see it just takes a little patience, but there's not much we cannot do as long as we apply delicate changes and we approach the technique with a little bit of patience. Now, the sort of things I think we need to be thinking about to really get the best from our images. If I turn that top layer off for a moment, even though I've brought through some of the lighter tones in the foliage there, these tones here are affected by this layer. So I've virtually got the maximum tone that I can get here. What if I wanted to make this a little bit brighter? Well, I would open this up, wouldn't I? Because that's the one that's affecting the tones. Double click that back up into Camera Raw. So what I could do now is just say, let's pick up my adjustment brush. I'm just looking at the settings here. I've got them down here rather than up, but I just need to make a couple of sweeps of my pen just to make a start. Then if I right click the pin, I can reset all of these because I want to go the other way. I want those to be lightened a little bit, maybe a little highlight. So now I can zoom in. I can adjust my brush using the square bracket keys. And I can just start to lift the tones in the foliage. You can see the flow rate is very low, about 6. In fact, I think I'd rather have it fully open like that so I can gauge it better. But you can see what I mean. If I'm going to go this way, I'm going to just do that even more carefully. But of course, when I click OK to open this, if you watch at the top right corner, and I'm not sure why my computer is talking to me, but if you look at the top right corner, you can see we've lifted the tones even more. Now, at this stage, I would be saving my work as a layered file, retaining the two smart objects. And if you look up at the top left, you can see exactly that happening. Because what I'm going to do now is say I'm happy with the work I've done so far. So I'm happy to move away from a layered image and I'm going to flatten the image because I need to deal with these lines in the sky. To do that, I'm going to add a new blank layer down at the bottom right of the layers, a new blank layer over the top of my background. We're going to be cloning or using the healing brush. So we take pixels from here, but we paint them onto here. Completely fail-safe way of working. If things don't go according to plan, we can erase some of the areas which don't work, or we can just dump the layer and have another go. But I think it's going to work pretty well. What I'll do is zoom in on the right-hand side. I need to pick up my spot healing brush. From the top of the screen, I want Content Aware as the selection from the type, and I need the little box ticked to sample all layers. Otherwise, we've got nothing to sample from. I need an appropriate size brush. Over here, I may just do this with a couple of little taps of my brush. And one tip when you're working with these tools, if you find the spot healing brush doesn't work for any particular reason, or you start to see the effects, switch to the healing brush. The only difference between the two is the healing brush needs you to make a cloning source point. Alt, click, You can clone, then paint over the top, but it will still blend it for you. But I think for the rest of this, we'll get on pretty good with the spot healing brush. And here's a tip to speed the process up. Make sure your brush just covers that area nicely. Click. Hold the shift key. Move a distance and click again. Look how quick that is. Hold the space bar, click and drag. Move further along, click again. So we can actually do this sort of thing super fast. Just make sure there's no evidence, and if there is evidence in any place, just stop and give it a touch. Now, I'm pretty certain that you don't need to watch me do this. It would become a little bit monotonous for you, but you can see that it's actually quick and easy to do, particularly in skies. But when you get to the foliage, if you have to switch to the other tool, no problem. It'll work a treat. So having removed those power lines, we're now ready to do some final touches. While I've still got my new blank layer, I'm going to do a little bit of gardening in the bottom right corner. Can you see there's lots of little bits of maybe leaves or stones that are just picking up the light and just providing us with a small distraction? Now, you may think these are too small to even worry about, and I know there's many people that wouldn't worry about them at all. But they're so easy to deal with the spot healing brush. And because we're working on a new blank layer, when I've done this little bit of work, I will be able to turn the layer on and off and give you an idea of the fact that they are a little bit more distracting sometimes than we first perceive they might be. So I'm just going to deal with all of these little bits and pieces that stand out boldly against the dark areas. There's always a limit. Every time I do this, I wonder what some people think when they see me touching these little spots. But really, attention to detail really is what makes one image stands out from the crowd in some instances. So let me hit Control Zero to fit the image back on screen. And then to give you a flavour of what we've done, both in the sky and in the foreground, I can turn that new blank layer on and off. And everything's looking good. You may notice too that I fixed a little dust mark in the sky there, at least I think it is, and a little dust mark there, although that looks rather big in the sky. So perhaps it was a natural hole in the cloud, and being an infrared shot, the dark sky is showing through strongly. Either way, I've removed it, along with all of the distractions. And of course, we'd need to save this again. But don't save over the top of your previously saved version. Save this with a slightly different name, so you've got the benefits to be able to come back to any level, should you need to. What I like about Photoshop these days is when you do save a big file, it will save in the background and allow you to keep on working. I was just about to say to you, if you look up at the top left, you can see the file is currently saving, but it did it so quick that it ended before I was able to speak. But it is useful sometimes to be able to carry on working while a large file is being saved. But now it has been saved, I can flatten my image because I want to move on just a little bit. The first thing I want to do now I've got it open in Photoshop is to bring up my levels, Control L. I just want to have a little look at that histogram. Because I've blended two parts of an image, sometimes I don't always get it perfect. So sometimes there's a little scope for a little bit of tweaking here and there. Sometimes the mid-tone looks good if you tweak it down, but I don't think I'm too far off in this instance. So I think I'll just cancel and we'll take a look at another tack. What I'd like to do is to see if I can do something with these tracks here, because this track goes over the hill, round, and then all the way up, and I'm sure there's a nice little house up there behind the trees, but I'd like to do something in this area to make the tracks more defined. Well, I think that's going to be pretty easy. If I use my zoom and click and drag, and if you wonder how I can just turn the brush here to the zoom, shortcut keys of Control and Spacebar. Any tool you have selected will be temporarily replaced by the zoom tool in plus. And if you touch Control Alt Spacebar, which is not as difficult as it may seem, then we've got the zoom minus. Very useful. The tool I want here is the burn tool. There it is, a little over halfway, just over halfway past the center point. I need to burn. I need to burn probably mid-tones, 5%. Probably I'll get away with a bit more than that, so I'll risk a 10% exposure. I'll drop my brush size down because this is what I want to change. You can see it's having a nice effect. Need it to be slightly stronger down at this point. And when you're doing this work and you've got your image zoomed in like this, from time to time it's good to just zoom out just to make sure you're not overdoing things. But I wonder if I can do anything with those little bits there. They're very small and almost insignificant, but let me change now from mid-tones to shadows, because these look maybe a little darker. Just want to make a little more of those. And this again is another one of those little attention to detail things. Up here, it's probably going to be back to mid-tones. Whether I can do anything here, I'm not entirely sure, but looks like I can. Can do a little bit, and then maybe up here. 10% now looks a little bit on the heavy side, so I'm going to drop it to 5. Because I like to be able to do this with a number of sweeps of the pen and not just one. And I made a bit of a mistake there, so if any time you do that, just hit the Control Z, undo, and come back at it again. But there you can see, attention to detail again. Very small points we're doing here. But nevertheless, they're probably worth the effort. Now it's amazing, isn't it? You can work around an image for a long, long time. And sometimes if you just walk away for a few minutes and come back, you see something. And I had to leave the computer for a few minutes for a phone call. And when I come back, I can see two things that I didn't see just a few minutes ago. Just going to pick up my spot healing brush, because there's a little spot right up at the top left and a couple of light areas right down in the foreground that I feel are just attracting my attention. But my intention was to come back at this point and say what I want to do is to just give a little bit more width to the image. So maybe I can go to image size. Normally the width and the height would be linked by this chain link. I'd like to remove the link, and I'll make this about 6,000 pixels. So I'm adding about 400 pixels on the width, but nothing on the height. And there we just get that little bit nicer panoramic view of the image. Now, of course, I'd be saving this as a finished piece of work, but there is something else I'd like to do once I've got it saved. Now, I've taken this image as far as I think I can in Adobe Camera Raw and Photoshop, and I've got this final image saved on my hard drive. But what I'd like to do now is to try one of the Nik Silver Effects Pro filters on this, because quite often when I get an image 90% of the way there, sometimes these filters just seem to be able to take me that final step, and I like to check out the monochromes just before I fully put them to bed, so to speak. With some of the filters we apply to images, it's always best to add the filter effect to a copy of the original. So hit Control J and make a copy of your layer. But I happen to know with the Nik filters, that does it for us. So all we need to do here is to go to the filter menu, Nik collection, and the ones I want, Silver Effects Pro 2. I do have a couple of favourites on here, so we're going to look at all of those. But I would go down many more just to make sure I'm not missing something. There's one here which I normally go to straight away. It's the harsh or high structure harsh. And look at the difference that makes. It just gives that lift, doesn't it? And when we look at a before and after, well, I'm well happy to accept that. The one next is the high structure, smooth. It's so similar. There's not a massive amount to choose between them. Although the smooth one does seem to add a little bit of a vignette around the edge, which probably helps a little bit too. But it's going to be a personal choice, isn't it? So I'm going to stay with my first choice, first of all, and click OK. Because already, once it's done its work and produced the effect, I'd save this as a derivative of my original. The good thing is we're working with a high-res image here, 20 megapixel, and the filters do not take very long to apply, as you've just seen. So I'm going to save this under a different name. So once I've got my Silver Effects Pro 2 derivative saved, I'll turn that off for a moment and we'll go back to the original because I'd like to look at least one other option. So going back to my filters and the Nick Collection and Silver Effects Pro, the one I'm looking at is this one here called Underexposed. Quite often when I select it, it takes the image a little too dark, and I think it does here. But of course, these on the left are only presets. We can take our cursor over to the right, and here we can increase the brightness. Now, I like what I'm looking at there. Now, let me just click the compare button to see a before and after. Although it's taking down some of the areas I lightened, it's taking down all of the whole of the picture. And I think it's got a nice derivative nature to it. In fact, I'm going to have a little more of that and say OK. Because it's a great thing to be able to make an image in Photoshop and Camera Raw, then make three or four derivatives of it, just live with them for a few days. This one just about to pop on screen. There we have it. So I've got to save this now. Now, of course, when we're in full creative flow, there's nothing stopping us from turning this one off, going back to our original, and going down some of the many other preset filters in that range to see if we can better what we've already produced. I think going back to my original choice, I think that's the one I'm going to live with here. So although I've got all of these saved, I'm going to flatten these together so we can compare this image with the one we started with. Now, when the original image comes on the screen, and all I've done here is just remove that magenta cast so we've got a better comparison, although I often say this, it's not an entirely fair comparison, but nice to do nevertheless. But once we've got used to our eyes on the contrast we've produced here, it does make the original look even more dull than it first appeared at the start. But that's half the battle with many of the images we look at in Camera Raw, or in Bridge, or in Lightroom. And that's looking at a small thumbnail amongst many and spotting its potential. Here I think we've got good composition. A really nice lead in to the picture, which we've exploited a little bit. And of course, we've got some good contrast, which we've managed to tease out from that infrared image. But to be honest, I think we could have done very much the same, even if we started with a color version. And don't forget, even at this stage, you've got the opportunity for adding colour tones, either overall or partial, blue, sepia, any other tone you wish. And of course, you can always duotone the image. Not forgetting, too, that even when we've more or less completed our image and it's no longer a smart object or a RAW file, we can still open it up into Camera Raw. Because if we go to Filter, Camera Raw filter, we still get the opportunity to use the tools that we're becoming more and more familiar with. So if we wanted to investigate split toning, duotone, then we've got the opportunity to do that here. And it really doesn't matter if we end up saving a half a dozen derivatives of the original image, because if we look at them in a few days, you'll find that the strongest one will make itself known to you. Thank you for watching, and I hope the video was helpful in some way. Don't forget that I do produce a monthly newsletter, and that also contains at least one video on a photographic subject. And we also have a dedicated photo forum at www.beckhamforum.com.au. Why not come along and join us?